BBC Audio presents Little Lifetimes by Jenny Eclair. 15-minute stories set in real time. It's about women behaving badly, and each episode stars a different actor, including Lesley Sharp, Imelda Staunton, Vicky Pepperdine, and Anne Reid. Little Lifetimes was produced by Sally Avens.
Ladies and gentlemen, due to adverse weather conditions, could you please return to your seats?
My husband is holding my hand. This is because we're experiencing turbulence and he doesn't like it. I'm not fussed, I'm used to turbulence. It's been that kind of marriage. Poor Michael. The things he lets himself in for. This time it's Venice. A three-night romantic break in a much more expensive hotel than the one we honeymooned in 25 years ago. I should have known then. The morning after our nuptials, as we ordered Bellinis for breakfast, his sperm still fresh inside me, I noticed that my husband of 24 hours couldn't help winking at the waitress. A short little 17-year-old cross-eyed Gina Lola Brigida look-alike. Adultery is second nature to Michael. Just as some people are left-handed or have a tick in their eye, he is unfaithful. And when I find out, which I inevitably do, he seems more surprised by the revelation than I am. Over the quarter of a century that we've been married, there have been four major love affairs, a dozen dalliances, and any number of one-night stands. These I can always spot by the humming. My husband hums after an easy leg over. They cheer him up. Just as some men need the occasional round of golf, Michael needs a bit of extramarital. He's the sort of man who's constantly looking for the opportunity of a knee trembler in a lift. I think it's a combination of being better looking than average, but just a tad shorter than he would like to be. Therefore, the more furious I am with him, the higher my heel. For example, when we go out for dinner tonight, I shall be wearing a 3-inch spike. I think both of us are hoping that by Sunday night, I shall be in something slightly less stabby. It's part of his punishment. The heels, the meals, the leather goods. This bumpy flight is extra salt to his wounds. Poor Michael. He's staring at the aircraft wings, willing them not to fall off, barely daring to blink. It's an unwritten rule that over this long weekend, I shall order the most expensive wine on the menu, and I shall insist on half a lobster starter at every opportunity. Then there's the shopping. I intend to mooch about the handbag shops until my husband is half dead with boredom. Let's face it, there's not much in this trip for him. Certainly no sex. I am in bedtime cold shoulder mode. Face full of moisturiser and a good book, covers pulled over my chest, bedside lamp on until I feel like switching it off. We shall not speak of his latest peccadillo. I'm not a picker of scabs, but I do enjoy a good sulk. I rather like perching on the moral high ground in my ridiculous heels, looking down at my foolish, slightly too short husband. The pinch of my shoes reminding me of what he has done and how much it hurts. The woman in question this time is young and pretty, so far so cliché. She's a receptionist at Jackson Black's, a pseudo-old-school gentleman's hairdresser's in St. James. All traditional wet shaves and something for the weekend, sir. This is meant to be ironic. Instead of mints, they keep a bowl of condoms on reception. Ha ha. My husband attends Black's for styling and grooming. There's quite a lot of Greek blood in Michael, which manifests itself in the form of a monobrow, a furry, greying caterpillar, which he likes to have expertly tweezed. Michael is a businessman. The fisherman eyebrows of his ancestors are something that must be professionally dealt with. Ooh, that was a big one. Like the sky is littered with potholes and this plane has no suspension. Anyway, the girl is in her 20s. I blame the recession. Minimum wage life can be very dull. All H&M leggings and Tupperware lunches. Then along comes Mr. Moneybags. Smells nice, likes Japanese food. Of course he does. They're the only restaurants where he can guarantee the waiters are shorter than he is. Seriously, most of my husband's affairs start with sushi. He's very good with chopsticks. I think as a younger man, he probably practiced. Some men use guitars to serenade the ladies. My husband uses his prowess with two sticks of bamboo. It's one of his sophisticated man-of-the-world tricks, knowing his nori from his nigiri. His philandering tendencies are given away by the fact that he is on first-name terms with the woman who sells perfume at Liberty's. When my husband is serious about one of his little girlfriends, he chooses her a signature scent, and the trouble with very expensive scent is that it lingers. As soon as Michael came home smelling literally of roses, tuberose with notes of coconut and musk, to be precise, I knew he was up to something. This perfume costs over £200 a bottle. It clings. I myself wear portrait of a lady. More cinnamon and sandalwood with overtones of ennui than ripe young rose. On a bad day, despite spritzing myself liberally with my exclusive Parisian perfume, I can still smell the fury on me. Waves of disappointment mixed with something that smells a bit like regret. Maybe I should leave him. But the trouble with Michael and I is that we actually get on rather well. Apart from playing around, he does very little that's annoying. It's just time he grew out of his hobby. Infidelity is for younger men, like skateboarding. Anyway, the next clue were the scratches on his back. When I pointed out these abrasions, he tried to fake eczema. He even bought tubes of emollient creams and bath products containing soya oil, talked vaguely of going to see a dermatologist, and proceeded to scratch himself all over, as if to camouflage the telltale talon tracks with self-inflicted decoy wounds. Dear God, he's 52. At this point, I could have confronted him, but I like to build a watertight case. I want names, dates, and preferably receipts. Don't get me wrong. There's evidence, and there's evidence. And what I really didn't want was underwear in the glove compartment. That's what I call overly forensic. When one is a woman approaching Spanx wearing age, the last thing one needs when reaching for a tin of travel sweets is to be confronted by the wisps of lace and cavernous satin cups that constitutes one's rival's knickers and bra. But that's what I got. I thought the bra was rather tarty, one of those diffusion ranges that look oh so designer from a distance, but on close inspection turn out to be rather cheap and nasty. Have you heard of that saying, why go out for a kebab when you've got steak at home? Well, sometimes my husband fancies a kebab. He has a penchant for girls who like Coca-Cola with their spirits and stagger around with blister plasters on their heels. Just girls, like bog-standard girls. Quite often they aren't very pretty, not close up. Very beautiful ones wouldn't give him a second look. He's like a magpie searching out slightly damaged goods. The one with a mole on her chin, the one with a lazy eye, the one who'd been to a bad cosmetic dentist and consequently looked like a ventriloquist's dummy. Girls with self-esteem issues tend to be easier quarry, quicker to chase into bed with raw fish and tissue-wrapped gifts from Liberty's. My husband's receptionist girlfriend is called Jessica Bridgewater. I'm grateful not to have a job which requires wearing a badge with my name on, but it did mean that she was easily identified. She even had a gold J necklace around her neck, another of my husband's trademark gifts. He is a man with a method. Sushi, initial necklace, perfume, suspicious mobile phone behaviour, careless mistake, denial, tears, promises and treats, yada yada. We don't have children, which is for the best. A lot of my friends are stuck with 20-somethings, massive cuckoos in their parents' nests. I couldn't be doing with that. Our nest is full of beige suede and glass-topped tables. I have a walk-in panelled wardrobe, complete with a bespoke hand-turned shoe rack in polished walnut. Sometimes I sit on the floor inside my walk-in wardrobe with the doors shut and I breathe in the scent of wood and leather. And I try not to cry. Poor Michael, he really is sweating now. His airport fresh Dan Brown book unopened on his lap. He's in the aisle seat keeping an eye on the cabin crew, not just the pretty ones. I think altitude is the only thing that doesn't give my husband an erection. Michael says once the air hostesses look worried, you're talking twin engine failure. People tend not to scream in this kind of turbulence, but they do gasp. Damn it, I've spilled carver all over my linen trousers. Never mind, I can buy new trousers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.